Let's work through some conditional probability example problems. I will assume you've already been introduced to the concepts of conditional probability and independence. Recall the conditional probability formula, where the probability of event A, given that event B occurs, is equal to the probability of the intersection of the two events, divided by the probability of event B, the event we are conditioning on. We do have the small proviso here, in that this conditional probability is only defined if the probability of B is non-zero. For the example problems in this video, I will sometimes use the conditional probability formula, and sometimes use the reduced sample space argument, rather than work through the formula explicitly. I recommend that you don't simply go running off to the formula every time, but instead try to give the problem some thought and try to come up with the best path to the answer. Here's a simple example to start with. If the probability of A is 0.34, the probability of B is 0.5, and the probability of A union B is 0.7, what is the probability of A given that B has occurred? For a problem like this, we could draw a Venn diagram and work it out visually, but let's try using the conditional probability formula. We need to find the probability of A given B, which is equal to the probability of the intersection of A and B over the probability of event B. Here, as is often the case, the denominator is easy to find, it's given in the question, but it's a little harder to find the numerator. Some people find it tempting to say that the probability of A intersect B is equal to the probability of A times the probability of B, but that's not the correct approach, as that statement is true if and only if A and B are independent, and there is nothing in this question that indicates that A and B are independent, and the reality is they are not independent here. So try not to make the mistake of simply assuming independence whenever it draws your fancy. We have to find the probability of the intersection another way. If we were given only the probability of A and the probability of B, this question would not be answerable, since we could not possibly determine the probability of the intersection from just the individual probabilities. But here we have another piece of information. We are given the probability of the union. So let's see if we can make use of that. Recall the addition rule, which states that the probability of the union is equal to the sum of the individual probabilities minus the probability of the intersection. So 0.7 equals 0.34 plus 0.5 minus the probability of the intersection of A and B, which implies that the probability of the intersection is 0.14. And so now we have the root to the answer. The probability of A given B is 0.14 over 0.5 or 0.28. Here, the knowledge that B has occurred has lowered the probability of A from 0.34 to 0.28. Suppose we are about to roll an ordinary, balanced, six-sided die once and observe the number on the top face. And suppose we define these events. The sample space is made up of the six possible numbers that we can roll. If we're rolling the die fairly and it's an ordinary die, then it's reasonable to assume that the six sample points are equally likely. What is the probability of A union B, given that event C occurs? First note that what we are given, what we are conditioning on, is to the right of the vertical bar. This statement does not mean the union of A with B given C. That simply doesn't make sense. We are looking for the probability of the union of A and B, given that event C has occurred. I might have written that with brackets, like this, but it's not necessary to do so, and we often leave them out. We could use the conditional probability formula, but I'm going to work through this question using the reduced sample space argument. If we are given that C has occurred, then that reduces our sample space down to just C, just the numbers 1, 3, and 5. What is the probability of A union B if we are in the reduced sample space? A union B is made up of all sample points in either A or B, so that union is made up of the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6. The three sample points in C are equally likely, and of those three sample points in C, two of them, the numbers 1 and 3, are also contained in A union B. So the probability of A union B, given C, is 2/3. I'll let you verify that using the conditional probability formula. A study investigated causes of sudden deaths in western regions of Paris, France. These were nonviolent deaths that occurred within 24 hours of the onset of symptoms. A sample of 523 such deaths revealed the following. In this table, 264 of the cases involved males dying from a cardiovascular cause, 27 involved females dying from a cerebral cause, and so on. If one of these cases is randomly selected, what is the probability the person was female? This isn't a conditional probability problem. It's just a very simple problem to start with. If one of these 523 cases is randomly selected, then each one of the cases is equally likely, and the probability of F, where F is the event that the person was female, is simply the number of females divided by the total number of cases. 164 over 523, or approximately 0.31. Given the cause was cardiovascular in nature, what is the probability the person was female? If we know the cause was cardiovascular, then that reduces the sample space down to just the cardiovascular cases. So we know it was one of these 353 cases. The usual probability rules apply to this reduced sample space. Given the cause was cardiovascular, CV for short, then the probability the person was female is 89 out of the 353 equally likely cases in our reduced sample space. I believe that's the best way to think through these types of problems, but if you insist on using the conditional probability formula, then we'd say that the probability of female, given the cause is cardiovascular, is equal to the probability of their intersection, female and cardiovascular, which is 89 over 523, divided by the probability of a cardiovascular death, which is 353 over 523. The 523s cancel, and we get exactly what we got above using the reduced sample space argument. And suppose we switch the conditioning, and we need to find the probability the death was cardiovascular in nature, given the person was female? Then our sample space is reduced to just females, and this conditional probability is 89 over 164. Given the cause was cerebral or respiratory in nature, what is the probability the person was male? Here the sample space gets reduced down to just the cerebral and respiratory causes, just these 130 cases. If it's one of these 130 cases, the probability the randomly selected person was male is the number of males, 38 plus 36, over the total number of individuals in the reduced sample space, 130. I'll let you verify that with the conditional probability formula. Now suppose that we have a situation like this, involving three events, A, B, and C. We are given all the relevant probabilities, and we need to find the conditional probability of A intersect C, given B intersect C. This probability isn't too hard to work out with the conditional probability formula, but let's try to visualize it with a Venn diagram. Most people find that easier. Here's a Venn diagram with events A, B, and C. Let's fill this out with the probabilities of the various regions. When filling out a three-way Venn diagram, we start with a three-way intersection, and the probability of the three-way intersection is given as 0.03. Then we work our way back out. The probability of B intersect C is 0.07, so the probability of this region must be 0.04. Using this logic, we continue to work our way back out. Back to the question at hand. What is the probability of A intersect C, given B intersect C? Since we are given B intersect C, that reduces our sample space down to this green region, the BC intersection. Given we are in that green region, what is the probability we are also in A intersect C? I'll outline the AC intersection here. Within the BC intersection, this green region, only the three-way intersection is also in A intersect C, so the probability of A intersect C given B intersect C is 0.03 over 0.03 plus 0.04. Note that this is exactly what the conditional probability formula tells us. The numerator in the conditional probability formula is just the probability of the three-way intersection, and the denominator is the probability of the event we are conditioning on, the probability of B intersect C. And when all is said and done, the final answer is 3 over 7. What is the probability of B complement given A union C? Conditioning on A union C reduces the sample space down to this green region, A or C or both. We need to find the probability that we are not in B, given we are in this green region. Which of the green regions are not in B? This one, and this one. So the conditional probability of B complement given A union C is the sum of the three probabilities, 0.18, 0.12, and 0.11, over the total of the six probabilities from the green regions, representing the probability of the union of A and C. This is exactly what the conditional probability formula tells us. It's just easier to visualize with the Venn diagram. That works out to 0.41 over 0.58, or approximately 0.707. Now let's look at some conceptual questions involving conditional probability. The remaining questions won't involve any calculations. It's not all about calculations. The bigger picture conceptual notions are very important as well. Suppose a Canadian adult is randomly selected. Let A be the event that the person is over 6 feet, or 183 centimeters, tall. Event B is the event that the person's sex is male. Is the probability of A given B equal to, less than, or greater than the unconditional probability of A? We don't know the relevant probabilities here, but that doesn't mean we can't answer the question. It would be this one, the probability of A given B equaling the probability of A, if A and B were independent events, which would mean in this case that the proportion of adults that are over 6 feet tall is the same for Canadian males as for Canadian females. But that's not the case. Males tend to be taller, and they certainly have a higher proportion that are quite tall, such as over 6 feet. So if we know the person is male, we are given event B, that makes it more likely that event A has also occurred. Here, even though we don't know the probabilities, we do know that the probability of A given B is greater than the probability of A. And if we thought of it the other way around, it works the same way. If a person is over 6 feet tall, that makes it more likely they are male, and the probability of B given A is greater than the probability of B. Now it turns out this relationship is always the case. Let's take ourselves out of this specific question for a moment and take a quick look at this in general terms. Here are the three possibilities that were listed, along with the conditional probability formulas for the probability of A given B and B given A. Recall from our discussion of independence that the case where the probability of A given B equals the probability of A, and the case where the probability of B given A equals the probability of B, occur together, and mean that A and B are independent. As long as both A and B have non-zero probabilities of occurring, these two statements are equivalent. In the conditional probability formulas, when A and B are independent, in the numerator we can write the probability of the intersection of A and B as the product of the individual probabilities, and then cancel terms here to end up with the probability of A, and cancel terms here to end up with the probability of B. What if the conditional probability of A given B is greater than the probability of A? That happens when the probability of the intersection is greater than it would be under independence. And if it's greater here, then it is, of course, also greater here, and the probability of B given A is greater than the probability of B. Each of these implies the other. And we could, of course, use the very same argument in the other direction. If the probability of the intersection is less than it would be under independence, then the probability of A given B is less than the probability of A, and the probability of B given A is less than the probability of B. Knowing that can sometimes help us think about conditional probability problems in different ways. Let's do one last concept question. Suppose event A is a subset of event B. In other words, every sample point in A is also in B. and that the probability of A is greater than 0. What can be said of the probability of A given B and the probability of B given A? Let's visualize this with a plot. Suppose we have an event B. If A is a subset of B, then A is contained entirely within B, which might look something like this. If we know that A has occurred, we are within A, then we know with certainty that B has occurred. If we're in the little circle, we must also be in the big circle. Nothing in A is outside of B. So in this scenario, the probability of B given A is 1. What can be said about the probability of A given B? Well, not much. It could be anything between 0 and 1, depending on the specifics of the situation. To illustrate, if we let A become a smaller and smaller part of B, then the probability of A given B tends towards 0. But it can't get all the way to 0, because A has positive probability by the initial premise. If we let A become a larger and larger part of B, then the probability of A given B tends toward 1. So we know only that the conditional probability of A given B lies between 0 and 1. And unless I'm really out of touch with the modern era, that makes for a pretty good party story.